presence of God and to study the Word of God together. Yes?
Amen.
So we praise God, we praise the Lord for this time that we have. And I really want to thank God for the whole week and for all of you who are with us. And that we study this Day of Atonement. Now, I just want to ask you and to welcome you before I ask you. Welcome everyone. And for those who are coming today, and some people are not here. But we really praise the Lord. Now, my question is, what is Atonement Day? What happened the Day of Atonement? What is really to atone, man? To be one with God. That means on the Day of Atonement, we need to be one with God. That's why it's called Atonement. Now, you know the man who was trying to even translate from Hebrew to English at that time, because he could not find the right word for that, for the word in Hebrew. So that's why he put that word Atonement, which means to be one. Because on that day, really, by the end of the Day of Atonement, if you study the Bible, and we saw it last night, but in the end of the Day of Atonement, remember that the Day of Atonement starts in the morning, but does not end in the morning. It ends in the afternoon. And in the afternoon, the priest, after he cleans the sanctuary, he comes out of the sanctuary, but he doesn't come with the empty hands. He brings something in his hand. What are those things? Huh? Sorry? Huh? He came. We read last night. Remember, my friends, almost remember? There are three things that he had to bring out of the sanctuary. Because when he cleans, he brings dirt in us, right? I mean dirt. But the Bible doesn't say dirt, but he gives a specific name. We saw that last night. What is that? He brings all what? All the iniquity of the children of Israel, all their transgression, and all their what? Now when he brings this, he comes from the sanctuary. But he goes into the outer court. Because in the outer court he found the what? There is a light bulb. So he brings the light bulb and he brings the sins, but the sin will be placed upon what? Upon the light bulb, which is the scapegoat. And that scapegoat, we saw it already. We found out that who is the scapegoat. We saw last night that the scapegoat is the devil. Now, did we saw it last night? Yes or no? You remember that? And we saw that there is a relationship between the scapegoat and what else? Sorry? My friend, are you really there? Are you really remembering? Because you cannot forget it. This is life and death. Now, let me remind you again about this. Now, we saw that there is a relationship between the scapegoat and what else? The self. Okay. It's always, you know, when you repeat something over and over again, then, because if we rush, we're not there. But if we go slowly, then we can learn. Now, and this is what we need to do. We need to go slowly. Now, brothers and sisters, I want you to really be very prayerful tonight, okay? Very prayerful. Okay, as you know, they told me I have a limited time, you know, the 40 minutes, 45 minutes, that's what the minute. That they say that from the time that I have to start, when it's 45 minutes, then I have to finish. Now, but remember this, brothers and sisters, there is really a limit. There is a limit for you. Everything that God does on time. Remember, when Jesus came as a lamb to die on the cross, he came on the time. You know that? They ever say, in the fullness of time, Jesus came. And when Jesus died, was on time. Do you think Jesus died on the exact year? Do you think Jesus, when died in the right year? Died in the right month? Died in the right, what is this? Day. Died in the right hour. Do you think so? The Bible says that. Jesus could not die any other day. He could die only on the first month of the, what day? Anyone remember? of the 14 days of the month. What hour? What hour? Anyone remember what hour? Right? The month, month 7. What hour? 3 o'clock in the afternoon. When you study the Bible, the Passover feast, the lamb always died at what day? 14 days of the Passover. You can read Leviticus 23. It's talk about all this. My brothers and sisters, that's why Jesus could not die any day. He had to die in the exact day. Now, when Jesus went in a holy place, he also went there on time. When Jesus left the holy place, moving to the most holy place, he also went there on time. My question is, God has a great clock of time which everything must be done on time, brothers and sisters. Now we saw this. This is talking about the duty, remember? What is the duty of the Day of Atonement? Tell me. We saw the duty of the Day of Atonement last time. And this verse talk about that if we do those duties, we shall never fall. Now my question is, you know, please, we cannot believe what the scholars say, but you know, let me give you an example. Because right now many people say, oh, the Greeks say, the Hebrews say, but I'm going to ask the question. Sometimes the Bible says certain things, but we come up with different ideas. Anyone here has a car? No one has a car. But let me give you another example. For example, you have a skirt. I'm going to talk about I wish I can talk about car, but no one has a car. I mean, we have only our friend here. He has a car. He doesn't have only one car, but notice this. Notice this, that when you have a skirt, and your skirt is like black, like that one, like my sister there. And then you know that the skirt is black. Because you see it with your eyes. Then somebody will come and will tell you, oh, actually, your skirt is not black. Your skirt is red. Then you laugh at that man, right? Because you know that the color of your skirt is what? Black. But many say, no, your skirt is not. Then you will ask him, why? Then he will tell you, because the Hebrew and Greek said, you will accept him? My brother, sister, we really, you know, that's the thing. The Bible says, be ye perfect as the Father in heaven is what? Somebody will come and say, no, that's not actually perfection. It's actually because the Hebrew say it's complete. My brother says, if you read the whole chapter of Matthew chapter 5, you see that what God is really actually talking about there is really that life which looks like Jesus. How you can have a pure heart? Jesus say, blessed is the pure in heart. Because that's the content. If you have a pure heart, you are brought back to the point that you look like Jesus. Because Jesus is pure. The Bible says in John that be ye pure, and anyone who has this hope purify himself just as he is pure. So, brothers and sisters, we cannot just accept everything that people say. But notice this, we need to believe what the Bible says. Amen?
Amen.
Now, the Bible has to speak. We have a lot of word of people, but let allow God to speak to us. We saw that these sanctuary mazes actually tell us everything that we're supposed to do. Now, and tonight we're going to start about that morning. Today is the duty of the congregation on the Day of Atonement, part 2. Because last night we talked about part 1, right? We saw that there was a duty. Remember this, the priest cleanse our sin from the most holy place. But remember this. He cannot cleanse sin if there is no sin. Did we saw that last time? Now we saw that Jesus cannot cleanse our sins if there is no sin. So that means that there is, you know, that's why I always say, you know, what Jesus is doing there affects our life here. You know that? And what we are doing here prevents the work of Jesus in the most holy place. And one of the things is, you look at this. If you will not give your sin, if I will not give my sin to Jesus, is there any sin, anything that Jesus can cleanse? No. Because remember this, brothers and sisters. God will use the last church to crush the head of Satan. He will not use any other church. He will not use the messianic church, which is the time of Abraham, all the way.
Do not use the what? The early church, which is the time of the sign, to crush the head of Satan. God is going to use what? The last church. Does the Bible say that?
Open Rome, Rome. Let's open Rome. I'm going to show you. This is the thing that I told you last time. This is the what? The servant. Amen. Now this is the servant. Whether you like it or not, but this is the servant. Now the servant must be received what? A crushing.
Amen.
Right? Now.
Are we together? Do you know who the servant, right? Now what?
The servant. You see?
You have power to kill the servant? Isn't one has power to kill the servant? That's servant then.
Anyone has power to kill that one?
Bible says only Jesus, but actually there is something that you have to do in order for Jesus to crush that servant.
Notice this. Notice this. This is the scapegoat. Now the crush, the what? Amen.
Now you're not saying amen, but Paul himself said amen.
I want to show you.
Now notice this, that this is the scapegoat. Now go to Romans before we go deeper in our study. Let's read again. Does the Bible say that Jesus is going to use the last? Remember this. For Jesus to crush the head of serpent, he must use what? When you kill a serpent, what do you kill? What do you kill with? You use something, right? Even though you are the one who want to kill it, but you must use something in your hand. Now, what Jesus is going to use in his hand to crush the head of serpent? Huh? Sin. We study that. You know, throughout our life, we always learn what? We learn that what? What we learn? We learned that the serpent was crushed where? On the cross. We found out this is wrong. Yes or no? We found out this is wrong. We learned wrong thing. Now the Bible says, that's why the prophet of the Lord said this. The prophet of the Lord said, the angel said, deny self. Let's read together. Deny self and ye must what? Step fast. Some of us have heard what? Time to get the truth and what else? And to advance step by step. Some of us, we know the truth and we should advance, but we are not advanced because we are doing the wrong thing. And it says, when I say wrong thing, it's not just sin, okay? Wrong thing is like we are not following the path. And the Bible says, thy way, O God, is where? Psalm 77, verse 13. Thy way, O God, is where? If you want to know how to live, how to eat, how to dress, or whatsoever you want to do, the way is in the sanctuary. Now he says, some of us have had time to get the truth, and by one step by step, and in every step we are will that we have taken, has given what? What have been given there? Strength. You take the net. But now the time is what? About the system. How many of you are really aware that time is up? Can I see the hand? I'm telling you. How many of you are aware that the time is done? Few people know. Those people who were with us, they know. But sister, listen to me. The time is done. I told you, if you are waiting for a pastor, or for your dad, or for your parent, to stand up and tell you, hey, stop compromising, it's time for you to get ready, do this and this, follow Jesus, do this, that time will never come. If you are waiting, do you think the Pope will tell you, the National Sunday Law is come, get ready, do this? You think he will tell you that? Never. But when this crisis will happen, the Bible says it will be a surprise, not just to the world. Right now, the world is waiting for the peace. But Jesus said a storm is coming. What the world is saying, there is a peace. Revelation. Daniel saying there will be a time of trouble such as never was. Now, we have seen many trouble in the world, brother Julie. World War I, that was a trap. World War II, that was a trap. There was a lot of killing, and the world actually recorded that this was what? Trouble time. But the Bible says everything that we have seen until now, it's pale compared what? To what is about to take place. Now, there will be a time of trouble such as we have never saw, since there was a nation, that means we need to pray. Such as we have never prayed. That means we need to study the Bible, such as we have never what? Studied. Because unless we get to that condition, to that level of prayer and study, we cannot make it. That That means our relationship with Jesus has to be more deep, not a casual relationship, but I have to be so close. I have to know Him personally. His love needs to be what? In my heart. My heart needs to be changed. There's some change that needs to happen in my heart before I be what?
My Bible says, and right now I'm telling you, we don't look like Jesus yet.
Now let's read this. But now time is almost finished. And what we have what? We learned how long? How long?
Yes. How old are you? How old are you?
You know, whatever is your age, for all this year, it seems that you wasted your time. Because he said, what we have learned for years, they will have to learn how? In a few months. What? What are you for 4 years, 20 years? I'm going to learn this for a few months. And they will also have what? Much.
I wonder if we have something to unlearn.
I wonder if there is things that we learn and it's wrong. They say there is much to unlearn.
You know, this is the devil.
No, I'm telling you, the devil can do anything to distract us. I don't believe this from God. Now, this is saying, you know, the devil can do anything.
When the mind of people is still open to listen to God's word, he can distract.
Now, I'm telling you, some people are not aware that the devil is real. And they think, oh, no, it's just normal. No, my friends. It's not normal. Now, what it says, they will have to learn how in a few months. They will also have what? To much unlearn and much to learn.
Brother and sister, that's why I showed you. That's why when we studied even the serpent, we found out that we learned throughout our life that the serpent was crossing the cross. The first day when I was sharing this, there was one friend from theology. So the friend after that, he came to me and was asking me, no, but what do you mean? Because Hebrews chapter 2 says that Jesus through death destroyed what? Have you heard of it? Jesus through death destroyed what? That's Hebrews 2 verse 14, 15, go down to 17. He said, Jesus through death destroyed what? Satan. But my question is, because we need to understand, brothers and sisters, the reason why we are confused is because we left the sanctuary. Now, let me ask you this. The brother was not correct because that's his question. Then I told him, we pray, and I told him, the sanctuary will answer the question. Let's see. He said, Jesus through death did what? Destroy what? Where did Jesus die here? Tell me. Jesus died here, right? Right? Jesus died here. Now, if Jesus by dying here, I'm going to say, are you intelligent? Right? Yes or no? Before I show you from the Bible and also from my other explanation, let me explain you this. Jesus died here. When Jesus died on the cross, was immediately Jesus destroyed, in the sanctuary. Okay, let's see in the sanctuary. Because in the sanctuary, everything starts here but doesn't finish it. Goes into the most holy place. Come back and then finish it. You know that? Now the question is, when Jesus died here, he was immediately destroyed the devil. Did he destroy the devil? Because the Bible, when he's saying that, that's why you cannot pick up one verse and then come to the conclusion, that's it. But you have to study every other passage of the Bible to understand how the plan of redemption is. Because the plan of redemption starts here, but does not finish here. Remember, Jesus, for him to crush the head of Satan, he cannot just die and then finish. Okay, I wish to show you the quotation. There are many quotations that I have to show you, but I'm just trying to explain clearly through the picture, because some of us are visual people. Now, what did he say? He said, Jesus died here, but the sin, right after, you know, the Bible says, the sin comes with the lamb, and you confess over the lamb, and the sins are transferred to the lamb, and immediately the lamb died. And when it died, the sin, where does sin go when the lamb died? Is sin gone? No. The sin goes into the blood. And the blood is taken by the second part of the plan of redemption, which is the priest taker. Going to the sanctuary here, splay the blood there, and then splay also in that side of the most holy place. But notice this in the video. But notice by the system. The sin stayed there for 1 year, and the priest does a cleansing on the day of atonement. And he take those sin, he came back, put it upon the scapegoat. Who is the scapegoat? We found out last night, he said. The Bible says in Revelation 20. Now, brothers and sisters, that means the sins going here, our sin when Jesus died on the cross,
Then the Bible says the sin must go there. That's why the Bible, the Spirit of God is in the Bible says our sin must go before him, judgment. We must be judged, brothers and sisters. And then our sins must come back. So if this is the picture of how the plan of redemption is, how you can tell me that Hebrews 2, verse 15 or 14 says that Jesus destroyed? Because if you pick up that verse, you don't understand. But the Bible says Jesus, because if you explain that way, that means Jesus right after he died. Because what is going to destroy Satan is the sins that are going to crush his head. Amen? Now, he says the sins, when he went to Jesus, didn't go immediately to Satan. Can we see that in the sanctuary? The sins went where? The most holy place. When they're in the sanctuary. And they come back. So that's how it's going. So brothers and sisters, that's why we cannot explain that way. So that's why we found out that we need to unlearn this. And from now on, we already know that Jesus did not crush the head of Satan where? On the cross. But someone was crushed on the cross. According to what? Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. And I will put enmity between thee and what? Open the Bible. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. I see many people look at me. I hope you know the verse. And open your Bible and check it out. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. That's the most powerful prophecy in the Bible. He says, I will put enmity between what? He and the wisdom. Say, he and the woman. Between what? Thy seed, which is the Satan seeds, and also her seed. Now, that her seed is one, singular, plural. That is singular. And then it says, it shall do what? Bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise what? How many people are bruised in the verse? How many people are bruised? Please tell me. Two people. But many people present this prophecy, but they never explain the second person. They always explain about the devil. You see? Because we don't know. Now we found out that the one who was, that Satan will be bruised, not now, by the end of the Day of Atonement. But Jesus here must bruise and was already bruised. Yes or no? We found out last night too, and the night before, that Jesus was bruised where? It was not Satan who was bruised on the cross. It was Jesus who was bruised, not in the head, but where? What bruised Jesus? Those who remember, I'm just explaining. What bruised Jesus? What Satan used to bruise Jesus? Sin. We saw it in the Bible, yes or no? We saw in the Bible that Jesus was wounded and was bruised because of our transgression. So the devil used sin, as the prophecy of Genesis says, to bruise the head of Satan. You know, the devil laughed at God. You know, even if you're intelligent, that's it. Look at it. That's why I told you, if you're intelligent, think with me. When you kill a serpent, you strike in the head. For he is deceived. Now, when you are striking a serpent, I kill a serpent many times. When you strike this in the head, never strike your serpent in the tail. It's going to kill you. Now, when you strike, have you ever struck a serpent? But when you strike a serpent, you know, on the head, it's finished, gone. So how is it that Jesus struck a serpent on the cross, but the devil is very real? He's walking around. He's bringing pornography, fornication, all the kind of sins, drugs, and people are dying. The cities, in the inner city especially, people are dying. You think it's because just they're doing it by themselves? No, the devil is real. And when we believe something like that, the Bible says even Satan himself cannot believe that what we believe on this. Now, brothers and sisters, I just give you a review. Now, we found out that on the Day of Atonement, the priest takes all the sins. But by the end of the Day of Atonement, he cleans completely, the sanctuary is cleansed. My question is, how much sin by the end is in the sanctuary when he finishes the cleansing? Zero sin. How much sin is with the congregation by the end of the Day of Atonement? Zero. Because the congregation on that day, on the end of the Day of Atonement, and also on the what? The sanctuary, no more sin. That's why you say, no more sin. If you study the Bible, it says, when the sanctuary service finished, no more sin. It's over. That was a shock. That was a shock. How much more than today? Which we are in the day of Atonement. Remember this. When Jesus will finish the world and will bring the sins put upon the no more finish all. That means by the end of the day of Atonement, even before Jesus left the sanctuary, the people, that's why the Bible says, who is sin continue to be what? Sin. Who is righteous continue to be what? Righteous. That's the time that Jesus already left there. No more intercession there. It's closed, but people here still live. But some people continue being evil. While some other people, because of the experience that they have with Jesus, no more fall. That's why the result of the three angels' message shall be this one. Amen. Now, we found out. Now, the question is, how Jesus going to crush? What Jesus going to use is going to use sin. But remember, Jesus doesn't use the time of Abraham. Doesn't use the time of what? Any other time, but he used the last time. Now, let's read together. Romans chapter 20. Romans chapter 16. Let's read. If the Bible says this generation is the one that's going to crush, Jesus is going to use to crush the head of Satan. Because remember this, because some people say, no, what do you mean I need to give my sin to Jesus so that Jesus can crush the head of Satan? Because Jesus must use this generation. Let's see in the Bible. Romans chapter 16. Romans chapter 16, the Bible says in verse 20, let me know by saying, amen. Amen. Now the Bible says, let's read together this. The Bible says this. The Bible says, what the Bible say? Okay. It says, and the God of peace shall bruise, and the shall, the tense is future, shall bruise Satan under what? The feet of you. Now, when Jesus is going to do that, and the grace of God, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and he say amen. When Paul understood this, he say amen. Is it in the Bible? Yes or no? Now he say amen, because the devil will be what? Head will be what? Crushed. Brother and sister, the devil head must be crushed. My question is, what Jesus gonna what? Use to crush the head? Now it says, shall bruise the what? Satan under your feet. My question is, to whom Paul was addressed the book of Romans? To the people? The people? How specifically? To the people? Rome. He's the people of Rome of the Church of Christ. Yes or no? Yes or no? Are you serious? Okay. The book of Rome was written for what? For the church which was where? In Rome. So the church that was written this letter is the church of God. Yes or no? Come on, guys. It's the church of God. Yes or no? Yes. God allowed him to write that letter to send this to. Now my question is, what the Bible say about Jesus? Jesus is the what? The head of the church. And the church is what? Now the church of God starts here all the way down to the feet. Now when you study, you will see that the time of Abraham must be what? Must be what? The church. And the head and the arms. And it was the power also what? Of the early church. But the Bible says God is going to bring. Remember this book was not written just for the Romans. It was written for us too. Because if it's not for us, then we can throw away. Now I said, the God of peace shall what? Shortly bruise on. Satan under your feet. Does the church have a feet? Does the church or the body of Christ has a feet? Because if Jesus has a feet, then he cannot walk. Does the body of Christ have a feet? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. Then the feet of Jesus is part of his what? Body. And if it's part of his body, it's what? It's also his church. And if it's the church of Jesus, the feet, then what do you think? What is the feet? Feet usually is what? The last part of the what? You know the last part of the body? Please don't tell me the last part of the body is here in the bed. The last part of the body is where?
In the feet.
So Jesus is used to crush the head of Satan under his feet, not what? Not his arms that will be up, Not this part. Not this part, but where? Does make sense? That this makes sense that I'm trying to tell you? Makes sense. President, dynamic makes sense. Brothers and sisters, that's why the head of Satan had to be crushed. Now, brothers and sisters, we found out that we are God. If that's the case, I will not use it. Now, we found out that Revelation chapter 14 is the chapter that will prepare us for the coming of the Lord. Now, we also saw Arabic. Okay. Now, brothers and sisters, what is this? Let me show you this. Okay. God is to look like what? To look like what? To look like Jesus. The goal here is to look like Jesus. Now, my question, this is how I'm going to believe. What we are studying this week is not something that we are made up. It's really not fundamental belief. And many people don't know it. You know, many people believe in the fundamental belief, but not in the Bible 100%. Like, they don't test it, because every doctrine should be tested by the word of God. God would never say that. Everything that we believe, before we believe even, do you know even before you believe in Sister White, you should actually test her whether she's a prophet? How many of you can really tell me that Sister White is a prophet from the Bible? Because most of us, we just been here, we text people, oh, she wrote this and this and that. But can you prove in the Bible that she's a prophet? Bible says, we need to make the Bible about everything. Now, but tonight, I hope I can show you a little bit there. Now, let's move. Now, when we go in the sanctuary, we found out the sanctuary is what? In the sanctuary, there's what we call fellowship. Okay, between the priest and the sin. If the priest, tell me something. If the sin, this is the sin, we go into the sanctuary. Remember, the sanctuary was made for sin. Amen? The sanctuary was made for what?
Sin.
It was not made for righteous. You want to know why? The sanctuary that we are studying was made for sinless and not for righteous. You want to know why? Because even when you enter the sanctuary, this is the gate, you see the altar of burnt offering. Sorry for this altar. This, and something is wrong with this. The horns of that altar is wrong. There is no such a thing like that. But notice this. This is, when you go in the sanctuary, before you go in the holy place, most holy place, you will see something called what? Altar of God. Burnt offering. In that altar, a lamb died. Who died that? Who represented the lamb? Jesus. Now, if I'm a righteous, and I'm going to Jesus with my righteousness, can Jesus really receive me? Or can I accept Jesus?
No.
I must be a sinner for me to what? To receive the benefit of Jesus. So that's why the sanctuary is a place for sinners who, when they go there, they are changed into what? Saints. Amen? Now, if you are righteous, you cannot go there. Okay. Cannot go. Now, we also saw last time that there is something that prevents us that we cannot see the beauty of Jesus. Anyone remember? Anyone remember? Oh man. Okay. Now, I told you that the sanctuary is a place of what? Fellowship. Yes or no? Now, many people think, you know what is that? You know what is it, right? This one. And that one is that. Many people think God is going to bring people to heaven like that. Without doing anything, just going to pull them and then go. You know, I see people, when you go to Pasera, many people think Christianity is a he's a skeleton. You know, there is a skeleton and walk and what? Walk a leg. In Paseo, there is a walk a leg. I see people, that's a walk a leg. But when they go to that thing, as long as they put their feet there, and they say that, they're just going up. They don't care about anything, they just want to go up. You know, Christianity is not like that. Christianity is something that you gotta walk together with God.
That's 1 Corinthians 3, verse 9. The Bible says, we are labeled together with God. Now, God cannot just pull us to heaven in that way. God is not an adulterer that will take people in that way. Now, let me show you. The prophet says, man cannot be told to heaven. Now, this prophet, when she saw this, in her time there was no car. But she saw a torture. And many people, she saw that many people think that Christianity is a total religion. That you just have to sit in that, go to church, give your time, offering, sing, and this and that, and without doing anything, and then say, Jesus, I want to save me. The Bible does not teach that. It says, there is no such thing like that. It says, man cannot be taught to heaven. People think they are taught, and when Jesus comes talking to heaven, there is no such thing, brothers and sisters. There is something that we need to do. That's why it says, while Jesus, the most holy place, claims our sins, we also have something to do. Yes or no? There is a duty of what? Of the congregation on the day of atonement. Now, this man cannot be told to have. He cannot what? Go as fast as passes. He must what? Himself use the oars and work as a labor what? Together with God. This is our high call. Now, for instance, this is, she mentioned oars. You know what is the oars? This is oars. Oars. There are two oars. If you have to cross the river, and then you only use one oar this time, going, what's going to happen to you? You're going to go only one step. And then some people also say, oh, no, no, let's use this oar. If you use this oar, you're going to go this side. You know, our church, for more than 100 years, almost 100 years, that we have been single in the same area because we are not doing what God said. Notice this. There are two oars. One is called faith, and another one is what? If you don't use those two words, no way. This is the sanctuary. In the sanctuary, there is two things. The priest, okay. The sinner comes with the lamb to ask for forgiveness. Yes or no? If the sinner will not go with the lamb, or if he will not go into the sanctuary, can he have forgiven of sin? No. There is a fellowship. Some people say, no, this is word. This is not word. It's a fellowship. Working together, what? With God. Because God, if we will not do the duty, brothers and sisters, then we are in trouble. Now let me show you. Peter, that 2 Peter 1, 3 also say the same thing, especially verse 10. Let's pick up verse 10. Verse 10 says, wherefore, let's read together. Wherefore? But this is it. I'm actually rushing. You want me to rush or to go slowly?
Slowly.
Slowly. Okay, let's go slowly, brothers and sisters. Let's go slowly. Please understand. When we go in the sanctuary, remember this. First, if I sin in the outer court or outside of the sanctuary, I must go in the sanctuary for me to have what? Forgiven of sin. Many people every day when they pray, they are going to the sanctuary, but you don't know. Anytime when you are praying, you are going to the sanctuary. But the thing is, some people think you pray, done, they go back again. No. There is something that we need to do. Now let's read verse 10. Verse 10. There are duties that we need to do on the day of atonement. Verse 10, the Bible says, God wants to make us partake of it. Verse 10 says, wherefore, the rather brethren, give diligence to make your calling and what else? And what else? You can share your Bible. To make your calling and your election out. And the Bible says, for if you preach this thing, that what it says? For if you teach this thing, or you give right a stand about this thing, it said, for if you are, what's going to happen if you do those things? Let's read together. For if we do this thing, what happens? So I have talked to many friends. I told you already last time. They say, what do you mean? We shall never fall. There is only one who cannot fall. David fall. Abraham fall. Isaac fall. All these people fall. Isaac lied. Abraham lied. All these people lie. And all of them commit something. But my question is, let me ask you a question. Is David our example? Now please. Last time when I asked this question, some people said yes. Is David our example?
No.
To follow. Is Abraham our example to follow?
No.
Is, even last time I say, my friend, who is our example that the Bible gave us?
Jesus.
We say that. Our only example that we have in Jesus Christ
who did not what? Sin, and no guy was found in his life. Everything or every mistake that written in the Bible that our elder in the Bible committed, they are written there so that we cannot pass there anymore. But today we see people who say, oh, David commit that thing, so I'm also going to do it. Great. So even in the time that you do, so you're already condemned. Why? Because you are doing the same thing. I mean, you know. David didn't know. David didn't have anyone perhaps to that God told him, you see, that man did wrong. But right now we have David, and even actually praying very hard, Lord, please, create me a new heart, because he knew that it was polluted. Be careful when people teach you. He says, for if we were, do this thing, we shall never. For my question is, where we must go that we will never fall again? Tell me. Where must we go? Because there is a place. Where is the place? The sanctuary. But where exactly? Where? And in the feet of Jesus, in the most holy place. Why is it in the most holy place? Tell me something. In the most holy place, there's only one furniture. What's the furniture in the most holy place? The Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant. What was in the Ark of the Covenant?
The Ten Commandments.
Now my question is, if we keep the commandment of God, shall we ever fall? That's a question. It's a good question, yes or no? If we keep, I'm not saying if we fall. I'm saying if we keep the commandment of God, shall we ever fall?
No.
Who's going to keep it? Revelation saying here is the presence of the Son. The presence of the Son of the Son, which does what? And have the which keep the commandment of God. They are not trying to keep it, they keep. And have the faith of Jesus. Those people are the result of the first, second, and the third angels' message. And until we receive this message, two brothers and sisters, remember this, God wants to keep us from falling. And we don't believe this. If we are faithful in doing our part and cooperate with God or with Him, God will work through us and what? To do the good pleasure of this world. Well. But He cannot work through us if we what? Make it up. You know, people don't like that. What do you mean? I thought that He's done everything. Yes, Jesus did it all for us, and He will cleanse faithfully, He will cleanse every sin. But my brothers and sisters, the Bible says, even though Jesus can cleanse the sanctuary, but if I do not confess my sin and give up from that, the Bible says I can be still lost. Why is it that some people will be lost? It's because they didn't follow what? The instruction of God. Even though they went to church, but they will be lost. They say, if we get eternal life, we must what? What? What can I see? Let us not be what? Deceived with the what? Often repeated such that we say what? All you have to do is to do what? You see, many people, this is what people say. All you have to do is what? The demons also believe. The demons also have faith. They also believe. I mean, they also believe and they know that there's God. Faith and what are what? Two oars, which you see, the two oars are faith and what? So if we say, I'm going to have my faith, and my faith is going to take me to heaven, you know, if you only want word, and you want to, what happened to you? You're going to turn what? In one place. You never cross the river. Now, if you say, I'm faith, I'm going to, like the cattle. Because the cattle say, we need what? Only word. That's what? And then what? What is going to happen to people? They want to turn one place. Jesus said, use the two. James 2:17. The Bible says, faith without word is what? Amen. Now, brothers and sisters, this is not a word, but it's a fellowship with God. Now, notice this, in the sanctuary there is a fellowship, there is a senior, and there is a priest. He said, let no man present the idea that man has a little or nothing to do in the great word of God. Do you know we need to overcome every sin? Every sin needs to be overcome by the power of Jesus Christ. Remember, in the blood of Jesus, there is not just power to forgive sin. Because people only, that's what I always say, people only know Jesus as the Alpha. As the Alpha. But people know nothing about Jesus as the Omega. They know everything about Jesus on the cross as a lamb to die. But they don't know anything about Jesus as the what? The second work of Jesus. Jesus on the, in the sanctuary worked as a lamb, and He worked as a what? Priest. Many people only know about Jesus to work as a what? Lamb. They do not know anything about what? Jesus to work as a what? This is the symbol of the sanctuary. As a Only. Now, friends, listen it. Let no man present idea. Say something like that. I said, because there is a word. For God does nothing for man. How many? Nothing for man. God will do nothing for you and me. And you are? No corporation, go home and see you. You are the man. And he says, neither say that after you have won, that all you can in your part. Jesus will help you. Jesus said, without me, you can do how much?
No.
Now, everything has to be with Jesus Christ. Can you see this? But the question is, remember this, because the great work is for us never fall. My question is, how we can do that? The Bible says, thy way, oh God, is where? In the sanctuary. Now, who is the way?
Jesus.
Now, we need to go where Jesus is in order for us what? To do this thing. Because he said, without me, if you are outside of the sanctuary, you can do nothing. But the 144,000, the Bible says, they follow the Lamb wherever what? When Jesus went out to court, they went there. Jesus went in the holy place, they went. In the most holy place, they also went there. And the Bible says they looked like Jesus. They found out. Never leave the world. The impression that what? On the mind. There's not even the impression in the mind of man. That he had what? That there is nothing to do in the power of man. But rather, do what? Don't hide. Teach them that what? Men have to cooperate with God to be what? Successful in the world of overcome. Now, brother and sister, I don't think I have time to show you everything tonight. But now, can you see that we have something to do? Yes or no? Do we have something to do? Yes or no? There is something for us to do, brothers and sisters, and people don't like to hear that. But don't be deceived, because he says, let no man deceive you. When you do that, we will do that not because we are forced to do it, but because we love to do it. Remember this. In the outer court, there were 242. How many those 242? Two. Labor and what else? The outer of what? The outer of what? The outer of burnt offering. Now, brothers and sisters, the outer of burnt offering, what happened to the outer of burnt offering? Sorry? Someone said burnt out sin, that's what it says. In the altar, what happened now? Let me just show you this. In the altar. In the altar, can you see this? What happened now? There are 242, yes or no? In the altar court. So the duties of that place are different from the duty in the holy place and also from the most holy place. A sinner, when he comes here, he confesses sin and he receives the righteousness of Jesus. As he forgives. But he must move on by himself. The experience in the holy place is different. The conversation, everything about their life has to be holy. That's why it's called a holy place. But I don't come to explain you this, but there is a bread and a candlestick and all. All of those represent Jesus. But Jesus said, we need also to be like that. Yes or no? Jesus said, you must be what? Light. And the bread represents the word of God. So that means if I don't study, I'm going to die. But I don't have time to explain you this. But remember this, each room there is duties. And also there is a duty here. The duty there, the Bible talks about that. But before I explain you this, let me explain you this. When you're in the house, right? In the house, there is a living room, there is a kitchen, and there is a bedroom, there is a bathroom. Yes or no? Now, when you go into the living room, what do you do in the living room? What is in the room in the living room? What's in the phone? Some people have TV, sofa, what else? Table. Now, when you go there, when you see the sofa, you don't take a bucket, something with the water, and then shower there. Because that's the living room. The furniture tell you what you're supposed to do in that room. Now, when you go in the kitchen, what is the point in the kitchen? The stove and whatever. And the purpose of the kitchen, right after you see the kitchen and the stove, your mind, what will you think? Here, I'm supposed to do one here. So, you don't need to study many things or even read to understand that. You just go there and you see the point of what? Here is to cook. But when you go in the bathroom, what do you do in the bathroom? You know what you do in the bathroom. Amen?
Amen.
Now you know what you do in the bathroom, right? Now when you go in the bedroom, you don't shower there. And when you go in the bathroom, you don't pick up the bed and then lay down sleep.
My brother and sister, the sanctuary is the same thing. When you go in the altar court, the lesson is we receive Jesus who died on the cross.
But it's deeper than that. But the Bible says we move in.
But when you go in the most holy place, there is only one furniture. And the wise men, Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13 says, what is the duty of man? He said, let us what?
Hear. This is conclusion. Not any other thing. He said, let us hear the conclusion. How much? All what? What is that?
All matter.
Oh, the conclusion of all matter. What is the conclusion of all matter? Fear God and do what? And what we're supposed to do? Heed. That's some second piece. Let me say, if you do this thing. He said, fear God and what? Keep his commandment. What else? Let's go. For this is the whole. What do we hope? No. For this is the whole duty of what? Seventh-day Adventist. Is that what he said? The duty of all men. But he said, this is sanctuary. Do you know that every passage of the Bible talk about the sanctuary? Every passage. Every verse, every chapter, every book that you found, you can read it from the Spirit of Prophecy. It says everything about the plan of redemption. And we have forgotten this. As a result, that's why we read certain verses of the Bible. We don't understand because we don't explain this. We are waiting for someone who knows Greek and Hebrew to explain us. If you are waiting for that, that time will never come. The Bible was made not just for scholars. The Bible was made what? For common people. Because salvation is not just for certain people, but it's for all of us. Now, go to last verse. 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Remember this. Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 14. Talk about the three angels who are messed. Do you think that there is a connection between the three angel messenger and this one? Revelation chapter 14 is the chapter that will prepare the people of God what? To meet the Lord. I told you already. And we studied that very much. Now, is there any connection between this and this? Listen, friends. We don't have time to explain you everything, but I'm going to just explain you perhaps one thing tonight. Listen this. Do you know that, okay, we studied the first angel messages in a Bible study. We took 2 weeks. You hear what I said? Just the first angel message, we took how many weeks? And we didn't even finish everything. But we found out God wanted a lot of things to work. There is a connection between this and this. Because in the most holy place, there is a duty for us to do. And the greatest work that Jesus could have to do in our life is that we must be changed and look like what? Fully like Jesus. And for us to look like Jesus, we must do what? We must do the duties of what? The congregation on the day of what? Now 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31. It's written in the calf, in a very big picture. Tell me what the verse said. Read that. For whether what? You eat, what else? Drink, what else? Or whatsoever you do, do how? This is what we call the duties of the congregation of the Levites. Now, we saw that our key, the reason why God gave us the Day of Atonement, so that we can do what? So that we can what? This is too quick for us to pass. Let's read this. I also what? I saw that men do not realize what they must do. There's a difference between be, verb to be is a very special verb. They say, be something that you must. The Bible says, if any man be not outside of Christ, by where? He's what? All things did what? And everything about that man is what? This is a revival reformation. So the Bible says any man who went in contact with Jesus, he changed. I see many people, he said they know Jesus, but 5 years ago, 1 year ago, the same way that they live, the same kind of sporting, the same kind of thing that I've done before, they should be in a new now. And they say they know Jesus. Really? Let's read this. I saw men who don't realize what they must be in order to live in the sight of the Lord without one. You know, if there is no high priest, right now you see, there's a forgiveness. But if there is no high priest, you are lost. They say without a high priest in the sanctuary in heaven, through the time of trouble that we started already this week, those who were receive the seal of God, will not be for everyone, only the servants of God. I wish to explain what I mean. He said, receive the seal of God, the seal of the living God, and are protected away in the time of trouble. Must reflect the image of Jesus. How? We studied this week that we don't look like Jesus. Yes or no? If we are honest with ourselves, all that we are going to say, Lord, I don't want to spend my time on TV anymore. On football and things like this. I won't spend my time where? Because brothers and sisters, there is a great work that needs to be done in our heart before Jesus takes us home. And this is gonna happen in that just that way. Now friend, listen this. Listen this. Listen this. The day of atonement. 1 Corinthians, this is the last thing that I'm gonna show you. 1 Corinthians say whether we eat or what? This is part of the duty. Or whatsoever we do, we should do what? Because the first angel's message says, fear God and do what? Give glory to him, for the hour of judgment has come in 1844. And do what? Worship him. So it to fear God and to give glory to him. My friend, tell me something. Can I see him and give glory to God in the same time? Yes or no? Can I stand and sit in the same time? There is something. If I stand with Jesus, something must happen in me for me to stand with Jesus. But remember, when Michael stand up, everyone who's going to be with him must stand up too. If Michael sits down, everything will be alright. But my question is, does my habit of eating and drink take or give the glory of God? Yes or no? What I eat, it can either give glory to God or what? Take the glory of God. Are we together? That's why the verse says, what I eat, do it for the glory of God. Because there are certain things that I can eat, it actually can what? Can break the law. Because my friend, listen to this. If I ate a food which destroyed my body, I'm going to show you more deeply tomorrow. If I ate a food which destroyed my body, do you think I'm giving glory to God? Huh? Do you think so? Because that food shortened my life. And remember, the duty on the most holy place is the keeping of what? God's law. When you go in that room, you gotta go willing, you gotta go be willing to what? Say, Lord, I want to keep your law, not because I'm forced to do it, because I love to do it. Jesus said, if you love me. So that means it takes love for me to keep the God's law. No law, I will never keep. So that means those people keep the commandment of God and have the faith of Jesus. They have the love of Jesus. As a result, they keep it. He said, you are my friend if you are. You do whatsoever I commanded you. That's all. Now, brothers and sisters, if I don't do it, that means I'm not what? I have a lack of love. Let me show you one more question. Friends, please tell me. Tell me. Please tell me. If my life has been shortened by kind of food, which is harm my body. I'm not giving glory to God. Because if my life has been shortened, that means I'm going to die early, right? And if I'm going to die early, I'm shortening my life. I'm shortening my life, what's going to happen? I'm breaking what commandment?
Six
commandments. We say what? I know people eat meat. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. People like to eat them. Yes, ma'am. But I'm going to show you from the Bible, from the spirit of prophecy, the reason why. You know what is the meaning of KFC? Anyone know what is the meaning of KFC? Sorry? Pizza what? Pizza what? Oh, there. You know, this means killing folks continually. Notice this. I'm going to show you something. I'm there. You know, listen. There are food that we can eat in an outer court, we cannot eat in a Muslim place. Right now, the Jews until now celebrate the Day of Atonement. Until now. You know that? And on the Day of Atonement, they don't eat nothing about faith. In the outer court, you can eat anything. There are places that we can go in the outer court. When you are in the outer court, you can go in the place of amusement. You can do all those. You can watch your movie, your Holy Hollywood, and all these things. You can listen to Jay-Z and all these things, but not in the most holy place. In the outer court, you can watch nothing, but not in the most holy place. In the outer court, you can dress the way that you want, you can eat what you want, but not in the most holy place. I'm going to show you tomorrow more deeply. And I hope you cannot just give up and go and don't come. Come, because you are going to study this, and you are going to see that God wants to teach us something. And I'm going to show you more deeply about this. Not tonight, but next time. Now we are going to end. We done. You want some more? You want some more?
Amen.
Tomorrow. Okay, you want some more, but tomorrow. I'm going to show you, brothers and sisters, I'm going to show you a lot of things. Okay? A lot of things. A lot of things that I'm going to show you. I just want you really to come. Then you see that God actually has something for us. Yes or no? Does God have something for us? Yes or no? Oh, please, guys. Okay, read with me this last one. Read with me this one. Please read this. Please, don't let anyone talk to you. Don't get distracted. Okay, maybe this one. It says, it is just what? As much sin to violate what? The law of our being as what? To break one of the ten what? Anything that I do with this part is a breaking of God's law. Now, I want to invite you to pray. My friends, we are not just to study this and that's it, going home like that. But the time that we are living right now, brothers and sisters, is almost over. I showed you last night and the night before that this National Sunday Law is running at a good speed. And our condition right now, my friends, is too bad. And our only hope is to go to Jesus. When the National Sunday Law will pass, our question will be only, am I ready for the coming of the Lord? That's the only thing. And many people will reject. The people who receive the first and the second and the third messages, they will back up and they will receive the mark of the beast. But we want to receive the seal of God. Amen? Let's pray together, friends. Let's take a time and asking God, I want to ask you reverently if you can deal with me, and then we will talk to Jesus. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this time. We thank you, Lord, that you have a lot to tell us. But Lord, we have a few time to study the word. Lord, we beg you, help us, please.
that we come tonight and study again together. Lord, there are duties, there are things that we need to say no to the world and embrace Jesus. There are things that we are embracing right now, Lord, so much so of the world that, Lord, as a result, we don't look like Jesus. We need your love in our heart, Lord. We need Jesus to help us. We found out, Lord, that we can do nothing without you. But we plead tonight, please bless my brothers and sisters here. Help us, Lord, that we may understand the duties of the Day of Atonement and also the work of the priest. And help us, whatever is the sin, whether it's selfishness or pride that we have in our hearts, help us to give this to the Lord before it's get too late. We thank you for loving us, for saving us. Oh Lord, we thank you for this great plan of redemption. Lord, we want to get ready before the National Sunday Law pass. Help us, Father. Help us, and allow that the youth may be prepared to receive the letter. Lord, you told us that we cannot receive the Holy Spirit in the condition that we are right now. So, Father, we beg you that whatever is the stumbling block that we have in our hearts, please, whatever is the thing that we plant in our heart, in our life, that you did not plant, please uproot it. We thank you for loving us, for forgiving us, for we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, thank you very much. Once more, I don't know if I should say sorry, but you know, we just do not know how much things we need for you to understand. And our time is so short. So I plead with you, please, tomorrow, bring all your friends. Whatever friends you have, come and let us all be here together. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Okay, thank you very much. God bless you. And I will see you tomorrow. In the same place, okay?